Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. In this module, we will study about oceanography. Oceanography word is made up of two words, ocean and graphy. Graphy means writing, means the study of the oceans. Before we start this module, let me give you some facts about oceans. Oceans cover about 70% area of this globe. About 97% water that is present on the earth is contained in the oceans. So, we can say that oceans are a pool of water, and the density of the ocean water is 1027 kilogram per meter cube, whereas the density of the continental water is 1000 kilogram per meter cube. So, we can say the density of the ocean water is more than the continental water. Ocean water is a storehouse of immense heat, and this immense heat helps us to keep the polar regions warmer through the mechanism of advection. In addition to this, oceans play an important role in the hydrological cycles. Oceans play an important role in the precipitations. Oceans are a big source of the energy, see, in the form of oils, etc. These are a big source of food, and oceans are a big source of minerals. Oceans may be, you can say, hundreds and hundreds mile long in horizontally, whereas vertically they are lesser deeper. The average depth of the oceans is 3.7 kilometer. With this background, the learning objectives of this module are bathymetric subdivision of the ocean, physical, biological and chemical properties of the ocean, and dynamics of ocean, and then we will try to find out the role of winds and tides in tsunami. You know that water is never static, this is always moving. Then we will try to know something about marine food web, and then we will discuss the mineral wealth of oceans. So, to introduce the subject, oceans occupies about 71% of the globe, as I have already told, and you all know it. It continuously destructs and burns. The oldest ocean is about 200 million year old. About 97% of the water on the globe is locked in the ocean. Let me give you one example about their formation and destruction. For the purpose of simplicity, this pool of saline water that is present on the globe, this is divided into five parts, that is Indian Ocean, Atlantic Ocean, Pacific Ocean, Arctic Ocean and Antarctic Ocean. The Indian Ocean has been formed due to the fracturing of Gondwana land. We all know that when the fractionation of Gondwana land took place, it was divided into India, Australia, Africa, America, and these all the land masses drifted into different direction. When these drifted into different direction, this led to the formation of these ocean, and this opened these oceans. So, the oceans has a latent lateral extent of several hundred kilometer through its average vertical extent is about 4 kilometer, or more safely we can say 3.7 kilometer. Ocean stores enormous amount of energy and heat that regulate the climate over the globe, that we will be discussing in detail. All the fresh water present on the continents is supplied by the oceans. Monsoon, that is lifeline of India, is also regulated by the ocean. Let me have a look on this figure. This figure is the schematic presentation of the divergent and convergent plate movement and destruction and formation of new ocean crust. Unlike the land, the ocean has very young age. It is because the ocean is born and destructed continuously. It burns at the spreading center, that is at mid-ocean ridges, and it destroys under the subduction zone. Now, let me discuss the subdivisions of the ocean. This figure shows the subdivisions of the ocean, and that we will be discussing in detail. Ocean can be divided into two margins. One is continental margin and second one is ocean plate. The continental margins is from land to the 200 meters water depth. In this portion of land, there is the part of continental plate that is currently submerged into ocean. It can further be divided into three components as shown in that figure. One is the continental shelf, second is continental slope, third is continental rise. The continental shelf is up to 120 or 140 meter deep. This is in no case more than 150 meter deep. As far as this ocean plate is concerned, ocean plate is more than 2500 meter water depth. This zone is mostly comprised of oceanic plates. It has further been divided into different components, and these components are abyssal plain and mid oceanic ridge. This mid oceanic ridge is separating center marked with the hills and ridges, and third zone is oceanic plate, that is with the trench and subduction zone. Now let we come to the physical characteristics of seawater. Ocean has a layered structure. The topmost layer of the ocean is called as mixed layer and is generally the warmest layer. It has homogeneous density, salinity and temperature. The next layer, that is the first layer, is mixed layer. Second layer is called as thermocline. This is a layer in which temperature drops. This layer also called as haline. This is a layer in which the salinity declines, and this is also called as pycnocline. And this is the intermediate layer in which density of seawater increases. Deep regions of ocean generally has a low temperature and high density. The first figure shows that how the variation of temperature take place in the ocean with the depth. The first figure shows that temperature decreases. The decrease is very less or almost constant in the mixed layer, but there is a significant change, significant decline in the thermohaline layer, and after that it remains comparatively constant. Let me come to the second figure, that is middle figure. Here this is regarding the salinity of the ocean. You will find that salinity of the ocean is constant in the mixed layer, but it decreases in the halohaline layer, and then it remains almost constant in the deeper part of the ocean. The third figure, that is on the right hand side, that shows the variation of density with depth in the ocean. This figure shows that density remains almost constant in the mixed layer, but it increases in the pycnocline layer, and it goes on increasing even in the deeper parts of the ocean. So in the physical properties, we have studied about temperature variation of the ocean, density variation of the ocean, and salinity variation of the ocean. And we have studied that how these three properties vary with depth in the ocean. Now let me come to the chemical properties of the ocean. The major constituents of the sea water are oxygen. 85.84% is the oxygen that is present in the seawater. Hydrogen, that is about 10.82%, chloride 1.94%, sodium 1.08%, magnesium 0.129%, calcium 0.04%, potassium 0.04%, sulfur 0.091%, and carbon, that is 0.0028%. The ratio of these elements remains almost constant in the ocean water. Sodium chloride, magnesium sulfate and calcium are the most abundant dissolved ion. Among these, it has been observed, or it has been reported by several authors, that the calcium composition may change. This change in the calcium composition may be due to that certain phytoplanktons, those are present in the ocean, they produce calcium carbonate. The salinity of seawater varies from 31 to 36 parts per thousand. The salinity is not uniform and it is regulated by the evaporation precipitation regime of a region. The seawater has a thermal conductivity of 0.6 watt per meter Kelvin at 25 degree C at the salinity of 35 gram per kilogram. The pH of the seawater ranges from 7.5 to 8.4. In the ocean, there is a carbonate buffering system that helps to maintain the pH of the ocean. So, I will suggest the students to please study about the carbonate bicarbonate mechanism in the ocean. Now, let me study the sea level. Sea level is highly dynamic and it continuously respond to hydrological cycle, global temperature, atmospheric and tectonic conditions. Higher global and local temperature induces melting of ice and that contributes a large amount of fresh water into sea, which rises sea level. Locking of water in the form of ice associated with a drop in the global and local temperature reduces sea level. Thermal expansion associated with higher sea surface temperature increases sea level. Tectonic instability and rearrangement of continent contributes to reduce or increase the size of ocean and the climate over the continent. It also contributes to alter sea level. Sea level has varied in the past because of a changes in global temperature, tectonic and in hydrological cycle. In past 2 million years, there have been several cycles of sea level fluctuations. About 20,000 years back, sea level was about 120 meter lower. The sea level changes in past 24,000 years are depicted in this diagram. This diagram shows the post-glacial sea level rise, and you can say, or you can find from this figure that since 24,000 year ago to today, about 120 to 140 meter sea level has risen. The about 24,000 year ago, or more safely we can say about 20,000 year ago, that was the last glacial. At that time the level was almost constant, but since then melting of water has resulted, and because of that up to 8,500 years there has been a sharp increase in the oceans. And from last 8,500 years, this sea level is almost constant. But in the last two centuries, the temperature has again this sea level has again started increasing at a comparatively faster rate, and this is due to the climate change. On average, the sea level increase at the rate of say 1 to 2 millimeter per year, but in the last years, or it has been predicted by the modeling that in the coming years in this 21st century, the total temperature increase may be up to 1 meter, and in some years this increase will be at a, can say, 16 to 20 or more than that mm per year. Dynamics of the sea. The ocean is constantly under motion, and this movement of the ocean is due to thermal gradient. The motion in seawater is consistently induced by winds, salinity, thermal and density gradients. Tidal and gravity waves, those are called as tsunamis, also introduce movement of sea water. Actually, what happened in the ocean, that at equators the temperature of the water is more. When the temperature of the water that is present in the ocean is more, whereas the water at the polar region is cooler, so water movement start from equator region to the polewards. And when water, hot water reaches at poleward, this movement of water is due to thermal gradient. When water reaches at poles, then this water sinks. And then this water sinks deeper and deeper, and then this water again start moving equatorward. So this all leads to the formation of the great conveyor belt, and this great conveyor belt is shown here in this phenomena. A global phenomena run by coupled unwheeling and downwheeling is shown in this slide. Water at the North Pole cools and become dense. You know, density is more at lower temperatures, and such water downwells sinks. Downwelled water is found to advect equatorward as bottom current. Winds or temperature gradient upwell ocean water that brings cold deep sea water to surface. Such waters move over the globe as warm surface currents, as shown in this diagram in red color. A coupled cold and warm network of currents has been termed as ocean conveyor belt. The conveyor belt is known to regulate the climate of the globe. Now, as told earlier, that water of ocean is always under motion, and there are several factors which are responsible for that. So we will study some of these factors. Motion of sea due to winds. The regional winds over the globe are produced due to irregular and seasonal variability of solar radiation associated with an inclination of axis of the earth. The polar regions have a very large seasonal variations in the amount of solar flux, that is heat, through, though at equator such variations are negligible. The winds are generated in response to such unequal distribution of heat over the globe. The winds are mostly easterly or westerly, and these regional winds occur in cells over the globe. Regional winds induce currents along the boundaries of all the major oceans as shown in this figure. Well driven currents along the western boundary in northern hemisphere, warm water of the equatorial region are advected poleward by winds along all the western boundaries in the northern hemisphere of all the major oceans in the form of a gear. These currents are relatively rapid. These currents transfer the equatorial heat to the polar regions. Wind driven currents along the eastern boundary in northern hemisphere, cold water in the form of a giant current advect equatorward along the eastern boundaries in the northern hemisphere. These currents are sluggish and occur as gyre coupled with warm poleward currents. A circumpolar current also exists around the Antarctica. This current prevents the heat transfer from equator to Antarctica. This current has aided accumulation of large snow over the southern pole and the Antarctica. Ocean has a number of different waves. Let we study these waves. Surfacial oscillation, as you see on a beach, is a manifestation of stress induced by winds over sea and restoring gravitational force. Waves are produced over a fetch when wind speed is much higher than that of water. The characteristics of waves are regulated by the speed and direction of wind, size of fetch, and the duration of the wind. And the same is shown in this slide. Locally, the waves are choppy and are called as sea waves. When leaving a fetch, waves become smoother, and these are called as swells. Swells have a property to propagate over the deeper water without any change. Wave induced littoral currents. The swells are very stable in the water that are deeper than half of their wavelength. Once waves enter the shelf, especially in the region that are shallower than half of their wavelength, the wave disintegrate. The height of waves and their speed in the shallow water is governed by depth of a region. When the waves enter the shallow shelf region with variable bathymetry, the speed and height of the waves undergo drastic variation. The waves therefore refracts in a basin. Over a littoral zone, a large variation in bathymetry causes a complex change in the speed of waves. Bathymetric changes lead to convergence or divergence of waves, which is a prime cause of formation of littoral currents. These currents are important because these carry a large amount of sand along the shore and nourish the coast. This phenomena also produces rip currents. Tsunamis are also a type of waves. Tsunami is a Japanese word. It means waves of the harbor. Tsunamis are solitary waves that are produced by gravitational force. A large slump over the continental slope, vertical displacement of ocean floor, and volcanogenic dumping into sea are the major processes that produce a tsunami. Tsunamis travel hundreds of kilometers from the point of origin and have a very large wavelength and very small wave height. These are not destructive in deeper water. Actually, when these tsunami waves starts, actually when these are in the open ocean, that time they cannot touch the bottom of the ocean. When these cannot touch the bottom of the ocean, then they don't disintegrate. But when these come in the shallow water near the coastal regions where the depth is lesser, these tsunami waves touch the bottom of the ocean, and as a result of that, the wave height is increases. So, in shallow water, due to depth water, there is an amplification in the speed and height of the tsunami. And when there is an increase in the speed and height of the tsunami due to disintegration, due to shallower depth, and that causes a large destruction in the coastal area. Now, let me come to the tide. Tides are semi-diurnal or diurnal changes in the sea level that are generated due to the gravitational pull of the celestial bodies. If the earth were a perfect sphere without any continents, all areas of the planet would have experienced two equally proportioned high and low tides every lunar day. The existence of large continents on the planet blocks the westward passage of the tidal bulges as the earth rotates on its axis. Unable to move freely around the globe, tides establish complex pattern within each ocean basin. This causes a change in the height and cycle of tides locally. Now, let me come to the marine life. Let me discuss the primary producers which are present in the ocean. The life in the ocean is sustained by the primary producer, which use photosynthesis to generate food. These organisms are generally green algae and seagrasses. The primary productivity is mostly carried out in sunlit layer of the ocean, and the sunlit layer of the ocean is up to 100 meter, and in the deeper ocean also some autotrophs live. Some primary production also occur at the deeper regions of the ocean which don't receive any light, and that is sustained by chemosynthetic processes. So, we can say there are two type of processes. One is photosynthetic processes and second are chemosynthetic processes. Photosynthetic processes take place in that region of the ocean that is up to the 100 meter depth up to which light can penetrate. In the remaining part, in the deeper part of the ocean, chemosynthetic processes take place. Secondary and tertiary levels in marine system, herbivores, unicellular animals such as zooplanktons, and secondary level in the pyramid. The small animal and large fish that dwell on smaller to next stage animals make a pyramid of marine web. Second and third levels, carnivorous animals, large fish such as dolphin and shark, the top carnivores occupy the top of the pyramid. The trophic levels of the ocean web are shown in this figure. You will find at the bottom there are the primary producers that mainly contain phytoplanktons and seabeds. The second level is occupied by the herbivores that are zooplanktons, and then higher levels are occupied by the carnivore animals. In ocean marine web, about 10% of the energy is transferred from the one trophic level to the other trophic level. Other energy is lost either in the form of waste or in the form of movement, etc. So, when there is a lesser transfer of energy from one level to the other level, to the higher level, so in that situation, there is a decrease in the number of animals with each trophic level. So, we can say, with this discussion, we can say there will be maximum number of organism at the bottom and minimum number at the top. So, we will be having a triangular pyramid of the sea ocean marine web. Ocean is a climate regulator. Ocean has a very large capacity to store heat contributed by the solar radiations, because water has very high heat capacity. The heat stored in the ocean regulates the climate of the earth. Oceans also store a large amount of greenhouse gases. The historical records of the climate of the earth suggest several cycles of cold, arid and humid phases. Ocean is known to influence cyclic changes in the climate of a region. Such events last for 2 to 7 years. El Nino and La Nina are some of the examples that depicts the role of ocean on global climate. Let me have a brief idea of El Nino. El Nino, also called as Southern Oscillation. The Western Pacific Ocean has a warm pool. This is the region which has stored a very large amount of heat in the ocean. A large evaporation from this region supplies moisture to atmosphere, and it sustains the Asian monsoon precipitation. Every 2 to 7 years, the warm pool is shifted eastward to the western shore of the Southern American continent. This phenomena is termed as El Nino, and this lead to a anomalous climate in the American continents. This phenomena is reported to have a complex influence on the Indian monsoon. This phenomena is shown in this slide. Ocean is a regulator of monsoon also. Monsoon is a wind system that carries ocean moisture to the continents. Indian monsoon is a advection of latent heat and moisture from the Southern Ocean to the Indian subcontinent. It is regulated by coupled heating or cooling of the Himalayas and the Southern Ocean. During the southwest monsoon, ocean winds blow from the Southern Ocean to the Indian subcontinent due to the pressure gradient between ocean and land associated with formation of a low pressure over the Himalayas. During northeast monsoon, winds blow from the land to the ocean due to a high pressure over the Himalayas. Ocean is a big source of mineral wealth. Ocean possesses a wealth of minerals. It is a major supplier of rock salt. It contains many precious metals such as gold, nickel, zinc, etc. You might have heard of the presence of manganese nodules at the bottom of oceans. I'll suggest the students please read about manganese nodules, and from that you will find out that how much wealth or how much metal is deposited at the bottom of the ocean. At present day, our main issue with that is that how to bring those manganese nodule from the bottom to the land. Once we develop that technology, we will get a very big source of minerals. In Africa, diamonds are found on beach as placer deposits. Polymetallic nodules and sulfide deposits are found in the deeper ocean. Majority of hydrocarbon reserves of the globe is located in the ocean. In this module, we have found that ocean is a source of biotic and abiotic resources. Ocean is a very big source of food. Ocean sustains life on globe as being the major source of water. Ocean's processes are critical in maintaining the carbon and oxygen over the climate, over the globe. Advection in the ocean maintaining global temperature. I hope you have enjoyed this module. Thank you.